let's go ahead and get started. For those of you who don't know, who just came for the food, this is the final meeting of the Nature's Colloquium in the Department of Anthropology. All year, Nikhil Anand and I, Nikhil unfortunately cannot be here today, have met with the second year PhD students and a number of outside speakers and internal speakers. And they've been working on their own projects the whole time. So we have a nice lineup today. We'll have several papers and then a short break to regroup, get some coffee and so on. And the students know that the papers are to be 10 minutes, and I plan to enforce the time discipline very strictly. Our first paper today is by Samantha Seiler, On the Margins of Empire, the Nature of State Making in the Comas Region of the Central Peruvian Andes.
Largely fought over Chile's access to the Nitrate Rich Atacama Desert, saw the Chilean occupation of Lima, Peru in January 1881. Andres Caceres, general of the Peruvian army, escaped from Lima and headed to the Central Highlands, where he planned on organizing a new army against the Chilean invaders. Caceres believed the landscape of the Central Highlands, characterized by rugged mountain ranges as well as the agriculturally productive Montaro Valley, would provide a strategic location for continued resistance to the Chilean army and draw resources and men away from Lima and the central Peruvian coast. Throughout Caceres' campaign in the Central Highlands, the Junin region and the Montaro Valley more specifically were forced to support both Peruvian and Chilean armies. In January 1882, the Chileans forced Caceres to retreat to Ayacucho, which is a little further south, and then occupied the cities of Concepcion and Huancayo in the Montaro Valley. In response to this prolonged occupation, peasants in the countryside in both the western and eastern mountains that border the Montaro Valley mobilized to form Montaneras, which are basically guerrilla bands. The Montaneras played an incredibly important role in the war against the Chileans. In one particularly successful ambush, the Montanero group of Comas, known as the Comasinos, attacked Chileans with rifles and boulders at Sierra Lumi Canyon and managed to kill 35 of the 40 Chilean soldiers. As the Montaneros became more organized, historian Florencia Malone notes an increase in anxiety among Junin elites, with some siding with the Chilean army and pressuring Montaneros in the Eastern Valley to surrender. For the sake of time, we'll skip through the rest of the war. Important points include the expulsion of Chilean forces from the city of Concepcion by the Comasinos, actually, and then eventually the entire department of Junin by September of 1882. In October of 1883, Miguel Iglesias, then head of the Peruvian government, signed the Treaty of Ancon, which gave the Chileans a piece of Peru's Atacama Desert and pushed the Chileans out of Lima. Caceres, after leading the civil war against Iglesias and ascending to the Peruvian presidency, eventually accepted this treaty as well. Following the acceptance of the Ancon Treaty, there is a big shift in Caceres' approach to the Montaneras, demonstrated in his execution of four peasant guerrillas in the town of Huancayo. So as a reminder, he's the one who's kind of originally organizing these guerrilla bands, but now that he's president, he's kind of trying to rein them in. So Caceres then embarks on a project to rein in the Montaneros and bring them back within state control. Malone documents different strategies employed by Caceres to control the peasant guerrilla bands that dotted the central Sierra landscape. The first strategy was the incorporation of guerrilla bands into the state structure through the creation of new independent districts in towns such as Ocoya and Maquiao. District status was appealing to towns with the status of an exo because it offered control over town revenues, access to labor for public projects, and increased control over political appointments. In the southern part of the Montaro Valley, Caceres again used district status to incorporate villages that participated in rural activity into the emerging Peruvian state. Here, after executing leaders in Chongos, Chongos Alto, and Huasicancha, Caceres dissolved the district of San Juan and placed the villages of Chongos Alto and Huasicancha within a district controlled by supporters of Caceres. So in the northern region, he is creating new districts, and in the south, he's kind of dissolving them. In the eastern region surrounding Comas, however, Caceres faced an entirely different situation. The Comasinos were less willing to put down their arms and were definitely not willing to give back the property and livestock they acquired during the War of the Pacific. In response to the government's request for the return of livestock and land, Comas and the surrounding towns and haciendas, including Unatuyo, Acobamba, and Andamarca, formed an independent peasant confederation. This confederation was based on the idea that each village would be relatively autonomous, but be obligated to join with other villages to fend off the Peruvian state or anyone else that kind of challenged their control of this area. Malone reads the development of this peasant confederation as a result of the development of a class consciousness in this particular region, and formulates this dynamic as one between patriotic peasant people, peasant class, and a hacendado class willing to collaborate with the Chileans. So in the north, Malone sees less class conflict and believes that that's why the villages associated with reelective are more easily incorporated into the state structure, while in the south, Malone interprets the higher degree of class conflict as the reason for continued resistance after the war. Instead of dividing the analysis of Montanera's responses to Caceres into north and south, however, I want to focus more on the geography of the region, and I think by instead interpreting the history through the comparison of the Mantaro Valley kind of proper to the region in the east, we can better understand the elite concerns within the Mantaro Valley and the response of communities outside of these urban centers. So in the literature, discussing the role of Comasinos in the War of the Pacific and the peasant republic that emerged out of the war, which is almost exclusively written by Florencia Malone, the Huni region is blatantly referred to as the Central Sierra. As I just mentioned, when Malone does distinguish between regions, it is most often in contrast between the northern half of the Mantaro Valley and the southern half. When we actually map the guerrilla villages that Caceres was trying to bring back under the state's control, however, we see an interesting pattern. We notice that Comas and the other villages that joined Comas to form the peasant republic are in a totally different landscape than the guerrilla bands of the Central Sierra, or the other guerrilla bands. The Mantaro Valley is a relatively flat landscape, nestled between mountains and known for its agricultural productivity. It's here in this valley floor where we see Huanta settlements, we see the reorganization and the elaboration of public works and administrative centers under the Inca Empire, and we see the placement of the first capital of Peru, Jauja. We know less about the eastern part of this region. Censuses and other colonial documents suggest villages such as Comas, Cochabamba, and Andamarca were originally dependent settlements associated with Huamalca, established that Huamalca had access to Montana resources such as coca and ahi. But other than the information contained in these documents, we know little else about this prehistory. While the pre-colonial history of the Eastern Valleys is here, recognizing the distinct geography of the eastern valleys and their distance from the political core of the Mantaro Valley, I would like to think about through James Scott's discussion of state spaces in the context of the Mantaro Valley. To briefly summarize, Scott defines non-state spaces as locations where, owing largely to geographic obstacles, the state is particularly has particular difficulty in establishing and maintaining its authority. For Scott, difficult and inaccessible terrains proved to be quite a problem for state control, and Scott argues that one of the most important state projects is the enclosure of these non-state spaces. And this enclosure, while framed as economic progress and social development, is really about making economic activities of different communities legible and taxable by the state. And in discussing the difficulty of the mountainous terrain of Southeast Asia, Scott offers the phrase friction of terrain to address the constraints different topographies place on state-making projects. And the degree of friction is not just an inherent element of the terrain, but also socially engineered with people actively manipulating their landscapes. Returning back to Comas and the other Eastern Valley villages that participated in the Comasino Federation, while these villages range between 54 and 100 kilometers away from the Mantaro, access to the Eastern Valleys is restricted by the Guadalupeano mountain range. So while the Eastern Valleys are not so distant as the crow flies, the terrain between the Mantaro Valley and the Comas and the villages further east would have constrained state-making projects in this area. The friction of terrain, both physical topography and the way that the guerrilla groups manipulated that topography, is linked back to throwing the boulders down on the Chileans and other stuff like that, kept the Peruvian government out of the Eastern Valleys for about 15 years. So I argue that the Comasinos' takeover of this region speaks to the inherent difficulty of maintaining state authority within this region. The Comasinos and their federation were not just criminals, so in a letter, Caceres refers to them as criminals, because they claimed the haciendas of mestizo elites, but also because they were autonomous, organized communities in a space that Caceres and the elites of the Mantaro Valley could not easily access or control. When the Comasino Federation fell apart in 1902 after its creation, about 50 years after creation, the government placed one of its first rural police outposts in the town of Comas. Around this time, the state built a road to the jungle and established an administrative office for labor acquisition in the Humane region. So really, the breakup of the Comasino Federation was part of a larger process of transforming the anti-state space of the Eastern Valleys as well as the areas beyond the Amazon into a landscape that was accessible, manageable, and taxable. 20th century modernization projects in this region were really about imposing these areas that largely remained outside of state control, or were areas where state control was tenuous at best. And in this telling of the story of the Comasinos, I think it's possible to tie the specific events that occurred during the War of the Pacific and in its aftermath to the previous insurrectionary project of Juan Santos Atahualpa in the 1740s and 1750s, and the later activities of the communist group the Shining Path in this area. Both projects, as well as other movements in the Central Sierra, such as the Kitsap Rebellion, use the Eastern Valleys as important intermediate zones from which to operate anti-state activities. As a rugged intermediate zone between the highland center of the Mataro Valley and the Amazon, the Eastern Valleys and the people living there were in a unique position vis-a-vis the state, whichever state that might be. And any interpretation of the rebellions of this area must include a discussion of the landscape of this region and its effects